All hail to you, Don Bosco, father and guide of youth. We come to you, Don Bosco, offering our love and praise. All hail to you, Don Bosco, father and guide of youth. We come to you, Don Bosco, offering our love and praise. We are sons in the church, signs and bearers of God's love. For young people who need care, who feel so abandoned, so aimless and lost, Don Bosco, guide and bless our work. All hail to you, Don Bosco, father and guide of Bosco, offering a love and praise. You have taught us cheerfulness as a means of holiness. You have given us Mary as mother, consoler, protector and help. Don Bosco, guide and bless our world. All hail to you, Don Bosco, father and guide of youth. We come to you, Don Bosco, offering our love and praise.
This miracle took place at Castel San Giovanni in the area of Piacenza by the order of a doctor. A 23-year-old girl, Teresa Calegari, was hospitalized for influenza pneumonia in November 1918. She recovered from pneumonia, but during her convalescence, she started to suffer from severe pains in her left knee, which began to swell with subsequent discharge of articulation fluid and ankylosis. She had a persistent fever of 38 degrees centigrade. The inflammation spread to the right knee and then to the joints of the feet and the arms, and her disease was diagnosed as contagious polyarthritis. The poor girl was completely immobilized, and for 6 months she endured atrocious pains. The disease of her joints was further aggravated by other serious complications: gastric endoenteritis, bladder disturbances with inability to discharge urine, constipation, and subsequent violent hemorrhaging, which weakened her even more. Persistent pains in the sacrolumbar region spread to the thighs so that she was able only to lie flat on her back. A swelling almost as large as a walnut appeared on the lower part of her spine at the third lumbar vertebra. By the end of 1919, her general condition improved slightly, though the polyarthritic condition was now chronic with total ankylosis of the left knee and spinal cord. The acute pains that had tormented her returned with greater intensity in January of the following year, though Dr. Minotti's treatment did bring her some relief during the summer. By October, however, her condition went from bad to worse. She had greater difficulty in eating. She was vomiting. She had stomach spasms. This was further complicated in January 1921 by a severe bronchial inflammation with secretions, chronic enterocolitis that resisted any treatment, an marasmic condition by which she could not partake of any nourishment. The physicians who were treating her declared her condition to be practically hopeless. This was the condition of her health when a friend of hers suggested that she make a novena to Don Bosco. The sister who nursed her also begged her to think about it. Full of renewed hope, Teresa mentioned it to the chaplain Father Zanelli, who advised her to begin the novena at once. She obeyed, but there was no improvement. The poor girl was convinced that she would never be cured, so she implored Don Bosco to help her, at least to die a holy death. In July, Father Zanelli urged her to begin a second novena with complete confidence. On July 16th, which was the eighth day of the novena, Teresa felt so ill that the nursing staff believed her end was at hand. At 4 o'clock in the morning of the 17th, after a sleepless night, she happened to glance in the direction of her night table and saw a priest coming toward her. He was of medium height, and his arms were crossed. His hair was black and curly. His eyes, too, were black. He put a hand on her forehead and, resting the other hand on the night table, asked her how she felt. As her only reply was a cry of anguish, he said imperatively, "Get up." When she apologized, saying that it was impossible, he repeated in Piedmontese dialect, "Buja le gambe," move your legs. Teresa could not understand the dialect, but when she did catch the word legs, she guessed that he had meant to say, "Move your legs." She tried at once to obey him and found to her amazement that she could move both legs quite easily and without feeling any pain. She was even able to bend her knees. She cried out to the sister, saying that she was cured. The sister thought she was deranged and came running to her. "Slow down," Teresa warned her, "lest you bump into Don Bosco." Don Bosco smiled as she said this. She had never seen a picture of Don Bosco, but because she had been praying to him for so long a time, she had no doubt whatsoever that he was the priest standing before her. Just then, Don Bosco raised both his hands, holding the palms turned outwards toward her, and moving backward with a smile, he disappeared. He had disappeared almost as into a fog. All of this happened to Teresa when she was fully awake. She was not dreaming. During the apparition, her eyesight became somewhat weak and blurred, but it gradually cleared up to the point that she was able to distinguish everything quite clearly. She flung aside her bedclothes and sprang out of bed. She crossed the floor in 4 swift strides, and going to see a friend in the nearby room, she gave her the joyful news. Then she moved toward nuns who were coming to see her. They were amazed. The other patients could not believe their eyes and crowded around her to touch her and convince themselves that what they saw was real. There was absolutely nothing wrong with her. The following day, this was confirmed by a thorough medical examination by Dr. Miotti.
Today we are praying the novena from the front part of the Pinardi house, where Mama Margaret used to have her vegetable garden. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
O God, come to our assistance.
O Lord, make haste to help us.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Let us pray. Today we shall pray for all the Salesian brothers, sisters, and priests, that they may become more ardent in their religious commitment. O Saint John Bosco, you founded the Salesian Society and the Institute of Daughters of Mary Help of Christians for the continuation an extension of the work on behalf of young people. Pray for all your sons and daughters, The members of these two religious families that inspired by your example and imbued with your spirit, they may be faithful to the religious consecration and steadfast in the salvation mission. Through your intercession, may God grant us the following graces. So that together with the sons and daughters of your religious families, we may assist and help young people. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Saint John Bosco,
pray for us.
Work among the poor and young, O Lord, we've heard your call. As living signs of your designs, Don Bosco leads us all. We live for you, and all we do for you alone. We see you when we work for all. We know they are your own. So help us, Lord, to go to words, a great salvation goal. Don Bosco leads our prayers and deeds. We're one in heart and soul. We live for you, and all we do for you alone. We see you when we work for